Hello there, very happy Saturday to you. Guess what? Surprise in the post today. Let's talk Doctor Who Season 20. Hello, welcome back to my world of stuff. My name, Paul Mount. Yeah, very pleasant surprise today. It's season 20 of Doctor Who, the new 9-disc Blu-ray box set, which officially is released on Monday the 18th, arrived today. I ordered this through HMV, obviously ages ago when it was a pre-release. Had an email Friday to say that the disc had shipped and was expected on Monday. And I thought, great, arriving on day of release. Had an email this morning to say it was arriving today, sometime between 10:15, 1:15. Had to pop out briefly this morning. When I got back, there it was, sitting in its very nice cardboard box, waiting for me to unwrap and unravel it. So this is by way of sort of an unboxing. Obviously, I've taken it out of the box, but I will go through, show you what the discs look like. And I've done these videos before for previous box sets. If you've got the previous box set, you know what they look like, because the format is very much the same. But always nice to see, especially if you haven't had your copy yet. Gives you a chance to sort of get the flavour of what it does look like. I can also do a quick review of some of it. Now, I haven't watched any of the episodes yet. I have, however, this afternoon, it's been a very pleasant few hours watching some of the new special features. These are always the main attraction of these sets for me. I know a lot of people, their mileage varies on how they approach these things. Some, I know, watch them disc by disc. Some watch the stories, then watch the special features. For me, I know these episodes so well. I don't feel the need to watch them all immediately, even though I know that it's the improved Blu-ray format, the improved picture and sound. I will get round to watching them. But I like to go into the new special features because I'm always interested to see what new angles that Russell Minton, and I think it's Chris Chapman, who basically are responsible for a lot of this stuff, the new angles that they find on presenting new material based on episodes which are, let's face it, in the case of this particular set, 40 years old. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to show you the discs and the set very briefly, and then I'm going to talk about the special features that I've watched this afternoon. This is season 20 then. It's a timely release, I suppose. It's Doctor Who's 60th anniversary, so it's probably the best time to release the previous anniversary box set for the 20th season, which was screened in 1983. This includes the serials from season 20 itself and the special edition, The Five Doctors, the anniversary episode that was shown in November, obviously, 1983. This is a story that's been released in very numerous different formats over the years, different editions, different edits, new special features, new special effects and so on. That's presented across three of the 9 discs on this set, as you'll see shortly. It's a new special edition again with new special effects. I haven't watched any of the episodes yet, so I might do a brief video later in the week just updating on my views on the episodes. So for now, let's just get on with looking at the set itself. So here it is then, season 20 in all its glory. This isn't a favourite season of mine, I have to admit. As an anniversary season, I think the stories, I found them a little bit wanting. It's Peter Davison's second season, and this was the season, as the anniversary, was supposed to feature some special reference to the past of Doctor Who. And as it turned out, that was a little bit underwhelming, because in the first story, Arc Infinity, we had the return of Omega, who was the rogue Time Lord who'd first appeared in the 10th anniversary special. In the second story, Snake Dance, we had the return of the Mara, who'd made their first appearance the year before. Then we had the Black Guardian trilogy, where Valentine Dahl's Black Guardian, who'd first appeared in the 16th season, reappeared. He appeared in 3 stories. That presumably supposed to be the link back to the past in those 3 stories. Plus, we had a return appearance of Nicholas Courtney's Brigadier Lethbridge Stewart in Mordred Undead. And then the season fizzled out, unfortunately, with The King's Demon, a 2-part historical-based adventure, which featured the return of the Master. The season was cut short because of industrial action, which meant that a planned Dalek serial, which I think was going to be called War Game or Wartime, had to be abandoned. So the series would have ended with the Daleks, but ended with a whimper with the Master. So, yeah, it's not a hugely exciting series, but the box set is, however, quite exciting. So here it is. Here's the box set. Season 20, the usual format, a very nice piece of Lee Binding art on the cover, showing the Doctor and his various adversaries from the story. You've got a Dalek there, because, of course, that reflects the five Doctors. You've got Omega, you've got a Snake Mara, the Master, creatures from Terminus, which is one of the dullest Doctor Who stories, I have to say. So, again, it's a lovely, really nice, beautifully presented box set. I'm very pleased it came in immaculate condition as well, no dents or dinks. There you are on the back. You've got the a nice piece of art illustration there, list of the stories, the special features, the usual sort of credits and stuff that you get. Then, of course, it comes in the usual J card, which I'm having trouble getting off. Oh, here it is. Come on. Right, there's the J card. Toss that to one side for the moment. So there's the set itself. There's the box set with, again, that beautiful artwork on the side. Interesting to see that they're keeping to the Jodie Whittaker era logo. Fans are in dispute about this at the moment, whether that should change, whether for the sake of uniformity, that logo, which has really been there since the beginning of the box set, Blu-ray box set range, whether it should change, I don't know. I don't get too worked up about stuff like that, but I think it would be nice to have that uniformity across the range. But of course, by the time the range ends, it's probably going to be another 10 years or so. That logo will probably have changed a couple of times since then. But anyway, it looks very nice. On the back, you've got a very nice piece of artwork of the Black Guardian threatening the TARDIS. And I'll just quickly whiz through this because it is the familiar format. Opens up in this sort of gatefold manner. I'll just move the camera a little bit there. Really nice piece of art here for the sealed section, which has got that sort of seal on it, which opens up. It's got the image of the four of the five Doctors from the five Doctors. It opens up as usual in that gatefold way. There you've got, I think it's the back cover image of the Doctor and various characters from the episode, Chameleon, Turlough, Mr. and Tegan. That opens up as it always does, and there you've got the usual souvenir booklet with, again, that same image, which is another excellent piece of reading by the look of it. It's 40 pages that, as usual for these booklets, chronicles the making of these episodes with some lovely new pieces of art, some nice colour photographs, interesting text. These books are just beautiful. On the back you've got colour pictures of the three companions. I always go for these box sets, the limited edition ones, because they're the luxury format, if you like. They are re-released a couple of years down the line in a cheaper format, but I've got them all like this, so I might as well carry on getting them all like this. You also get the usual sort of more exciting products from Doctor Who leaflet, which tells you all the different books and bits and bobs you can get. Fraser Hines' new book, BBC Audios, all the odds and sods. And there we have a really nice piece of art, as you can see if I open it up properly, of the interior of the TARDIS looking mean and moody. And then, of course, moving across, as I put these back in place, seal them up, you get the discs themselves in their trays. There's nine of them. Ark of Infinity, Snick Dance, Mordrin Undead, Terminus, Enlightenment, King's Demons, and then the discs for the five Doctors. You can see that there's one missing at the end. That's because I've been watching some of the special features on one of the five Doctors discs this afternoon. Speaking of which, let's talk about them now. So there we are, that's the set. Hope you don't mind that I haven't dwelt on it in enormous detail, but you know the format, you know how they look. I just wanted to give you a rough idea of what's on the way if you've ordered it. You may well have had yours today as well, because they do seem to send them out quite early. There it is, in all its beautiful boxed glory. Right, so just talking briefly about the special features. As I said, I'm one of those people who goes to the special features first. Excuse me. Because I just like to see what they come up with. And they've come up with some really charming stuff on this set. There's a lot of stuff on here, actually, new material. And there's also, of course, as well as all the stuff that was on previous DVD releases, I think there's lots of new archive stuff as well, convention footage and bits and pieces that have been found since. I never really get around to doing a comparison, comparing and contrasting, because I'm more interested in the exclusive, the newly filmed material. And there is a lot here. There's a lot here. And the stuff I've watched this afternoon, I've really enjoyed. In no particular order, though, in fact, in the order I watched them, I suppose, there's a very nice feature on the Snake Dance disc, which has Janet Fielding. Janet Fielding, incidentally, plays Tegan. She's all over this box set like a rash. If you are a person who finds Janet Fielding a bit too much, a bit too in your face, you might want to stagger your way through these things, because she's all the way through these things, and she is Janet Fielding. She's loud, amusing, a bit much. So if you can only take a certain amount of Janet Fielding, you want to take your time going through this stuff, because she's there in full effect right the way through the set. I find her quite endearing because she's always got something to say. And there was a very special relationship between her and the rest of the cast. But I'll get back to that. The first feature I watched then is from Snake Dance. It's Janet Fielding talking to Martin Clunis, who, of course, was a guest star in Snake Dance. It was his first TV appearance. And it's one of those things that whenever he appears on chat shows and things and retrospectives, they always dig out a clip from Snake Dance to embarrass him. And he meets up with Janet for the first time in 20-odd years, I think. They meet at the Sigmund Freud Museum, which I assume is in London, because, of course, Snake Dance is all about dreams and fantasy and stuff. And they spend 20, 23 minutes just discussing his career to an extent, plus more about his memories of working on Snake Dance. And contrary to popular belief, he has very fond memories of working on it. He remembers it quite well. He remembers having a crush on Janet. He remembers some of the props that he's shown, the prop hat and the snake thing. And it's a time he remembers with great affection. It's a really nice little piece. And it is nice to see somebody who, let's face it, is a big TV star, Martin Clunes, who's prepared to embrace his past and talk about it in this way. And it's a nice, warm little piece. I next watched a piece which is on the King's Demons disc, which is a sort of a making of, behind the scenes making of thing. It's the only serial that didn't have one previously. And it's a new police piece that sees the cast and some of the crew return to, I think it's Bodleham Castle. I'll put the right name down the bottom here. Where they filmed the exterior scenes for, I think, the first of the two episodes. I think only one episode has got location scenes. And I think the second, it's mainly studio. This very atmospheric castle where they filmed this story, set at the time of King John, and it's quite a low-key plot with the master planning to sabotage the signing of the Magna Carta. Throwaway story, but it's a very interesting documentary. Again, it's got Peter Davison, Janet Fielding, and Mark Strickson, who played Turlough, who by halfway through the series has joined the TARDIS crew. They go back to the castle and they reminisce about their time making the episodes there, and the various members of cast. Also there we have Isla Blair, who appeared in the story, Tony Virgo, who directed it, Christopher Villiers, with some archive footage of the late Frank Windsor, who appeared as the king in the story. It's a typical sort of talking heads making of documentary, but it's nice to see. It's nice to have this series rounded off with its own making of, as it didn't have before. Nice little piece, 35 minutes, something like that. The last disc then is the one that's got the two big chunky new features. I think it's on the last disc. It's in my machine at the moment, so I can't confirm. I think it's the last disc. It's got the two big documentaries, and these are the ones that you may have to pace yourself with, because they are they're quite brash. The first one I watched is called Let's Go Dutch, which shows Mark Strickson, who played Turlough, taking Peter Davison, Janet Fielding and Sarah Sutton, who played Nyssa, back to Amsterdam to revisit the filming locations of the season opener, The Ark of Infinity. It's quite a long piece. It's about an hour and a quarter, and it shows them meeting up at Pancras Station, then heading across to Amsterdam. And it's nice. It's sort of split into two distinct segments, I think, really. The first half is them on the train, and they're just sitting there, shooting the breeze, talking about Doctor Who and their experiences. It's really nice. It's like watching four old friends just having a chat, and we're just observing them, listening to them, having a laugh. And you do notice the ease of the relationship between them, how the banter and the piss-taking that goes on between people who know each other really well, that easy sort of a cheeky relationship, and you know they're all very much at ease, and it makes you feel at ease watching it. Actually, it's very relaxing watch because they're just sitting on this train. They've all got some piece of Doctor Who literature in front of them that they don't really refer to very much, but they're just having a good time just chatting. Peter Davison's often been seen as a bit cold and a bit abrasive about his time on Doctor Who, but I think he is now embracing it in a really nice way. He just seems quite relaxed talking about it. I think he's always been quite honest about, you know, the strengths and weaknesses of the show in the 80s, and there's no reason why he shouldn't be, why anybody should be, because, you know, the show wasn't perfect at that time. It's never been perfect, I suppose, but it's a really nice half of the film, and you sort of almost want it to be just that, because they're just sitting on this train, chatting quite informally. It just comes across as very naturalistic. Then they arrive in Amsterdam, and Mark Strickson, if you're wondering why he's in it, incidentally, because he isn't in the story, he is now a filmmaker himself, and I think he's just used as sort of a host. And he takes them around some of the various locations around Amsterdam that they used to film the story. And, of course, so many of those locations haven't changed a lot, particularly places like Frankendal, which is the big sort of manor house where they filmed some sequences, the jetty area where they filmed the conclusion of the story where Omega meets his maker. That's completely unchanged, really. Some of the surroundings, there are new buildings and so on, but the actual places are much the same. There's a bridge area where in the original story there was one of these sort of organ-type things playing Tulips from Amsterdam. They actually arranged for that original organ that was in the story to be brought back to the location, and that's there. And they're just walking around having a good time, and, of course, they're all complaining about, you know, they don't have to run around because they're in their 60s now. But it's just, it's a really nice, warm little piece. I mean, some people might find it irritating. Hardcore Doctor Who fans about facts and seriousness might find the flippancy a bit irritating, but I just say, lighten up. This is three senior actors who've got a long history of Doctor Who just having a nice time in each other's company and giving the viewers a nice, relaxing time as well. So, yeah, if you're looking for hardcore Doctor Who debates, then look somewhere else, because that's not what these documentaries are for. Also on the disc is... I can't think what it's called now, actually. Yeah, it's A Trip to Germany. I can't think what the actual title of the piece is now. Wait. Let's see if I can find it on here. Anyway, it's a new documentary. I think it was filmed in 2019, actually. It was pre-pandemic. And it's, again, the core cast from that time, Peter Davison, Janet Fielding and Sarah Sutton, going on a road trip from Ramsgate to Kassel, in Germany, where there was a Doctor Who convention being held. They'd been invited to go. I think it was Janet Fielding's idea to sort of document it by way of a documentary that's produced by Russell Minton. And it's about an hour and 10 minutes. It's good fun. It is very much in the manner of those documentaries you get on TV these days. That's probably where the idea came from, of celebrities doing things, travelling, going places, getting experiences and so on. And it's the three of these in this Range Rover driving across Europe, sniping at each other, having a laugh at each other's expense, enjoying each other's company again. They stop off at one point in Belgium to have some special chocolates made. So it's got that element that you get in these documentaries with celebrities learning a new skill or doing something unusual. Again, I really enjoyed watching. It's just, I think maybe because it's today, it's a rainy, grim Saturday afternoon. And it was nice just to sit and watch these people who I've seen on TV for so many years, just having a laugh with each other. And I think, you know, as you get older, that's what you want to do. You want to, you know, see your friends and just people that you're relaxed with. And it's nice to see that's what comes across, is that these three people just having a good time together. You know, they're driving across Europe. None of them very confident about driving on the other side of the road. It's just good fun. Again, if you want hardcore Doctor Who trivia and looking at analysing the subtext of Doctor Who and stuff like the contemporary cultural resonances, this isn't what that's for. It's for watching these people who worked together 40 years ago, who are still good friends, having a good time. Really enjoyed watching both of those documentaries this afternoon. I've also watched, because every story has its Behind the Sofa, which is where various Doctor Who alumni watch truncated versions of the stories. I watched the one for Snake Dance, which has got Janet Fielding, Sarah Sutton, Mark Strickson, Peter Davison. It's got Colin Baker and Sylvester McCoy on another couch. And Katie Manning and Sophie Aldred, on another one, watching and commenting on the episodes and just observations and things. These are watch once things, really. You wouldn't necessarily go back to watch them again, but they're just nice. It's quite good fun to see the reactions, not just the people who are in the episodes, but people who probably haven't seen them before, and what they think of watching them with the benefit of hindsight, as it were. So I've only watched the one. I'll watch probably the rest of them tonight. And I think, in terms of the new special features, I think that's it. It's quite a lot. From what I've seen so far, I've spent 4 hours, I suppose, watching a lot of these new documentaries. And there's the Behind the Sofas, and there may well be other bits and bobs that I'll stumble across. Again, it's another great box set at the end of the day. The episodes may not be Doctor Who at its finest, but I think this is another beautiful presentation. And again, I'm sure I've said this on previous videos about these sets, it makes you realise how lucky we are that the people who archive Doctor Who present these things work so hard to present these things in the best possible light, because lesser companies than the BBC, and there are some, would have just tossed these things out on barely remastered discs. They might have just chucked over the previous special features, but they go the extra mile to make sure that fans get the most that they possibly can. And I know they're not cheap. This is 54-55 quid, but I won't be buying these again in any other format, because there's no need to. It's just great. Hours and hours of entertainment. Of course, something I've forgotten about, actually, I haven't mentioned because I haven't watched it yet. There's a Matthew Sweet chat with Janet Fielding and Sarah Sutton. That's probably about an hour, and I haven't even mentioned that, let alone watched it. So there's all, like I say, updated special effects on several stories. It's brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant. Like I say, not my favourite season of Doctor Who by any stretch of the imagination. And in fact, when I heard it was coming out, or it was on the way a year or so ago, I thought, you know, I might miss that, give that a miss, because... But no, that's not going to happen. I mean, I bought the Colin Baker and Sylvester McCoy seasons. They're not my favourites either. So I was always going to get this. And so far, from what I've seen, it's another smash hit for the Doctor Who Blu-ray range. It's out officially on Monday. If you get it in the shops, you'll pop to your HMV or whatever. But if you've ordered it online, which I think is the best way to get your physical media, you may well have had it today. If you have, why not pop a comment down below? Let me know what you thought of it, if you've had a chance to look at any of it yet. And your hopes for it, if you haven't had it yet. Also, like and subscribe, please. Like and subscribe to this channel. Things were frozen again at the moment. It's quite odd. I'm doing more Doctor Who content, not in a cynical sense, because I thought, oh, I'll get lots more subscribers. But I did think that it would get a bit more interest. But traffic is a bit sluggish on the most recent Doctor Who videos I've done. So if you're a Doctor Who fan, come on, stay on board. There's a lot more Doctor Who stuff to come, including my rankings of the Doctors, which I'm going to get started on next week, and my ongoing Doctor Who Revisited, where I watch a random Doctor Who serial and just chat about it, not by way of a reaction video, but just chatting about some observations from having watched it. So if you're a Doctor Who fan, there's lots to come on this channel, plus the usual film reviews, media updates, cinema visits, all that sort of stuff. So go on, you might as well subscribe. Thank you for watching. Anyway, let me know what you think of the season 20 box set, if you're looking forward to it, if you've got it, what you thought of it so far. I'll see you soon. Until I do, yeah, keep taking this stuff.